Take your hat off. Name, Hitchcock, comma, Alfred. Height, 5'6". Weight, prisoner refuses to make a statement. Here's his record. 1940, picked up on suspicion. 1942, spellbound. 1944, notorious. 1955, rear window. 1956, the man who knew too much. Anything to say, Hitchcock?
Well, sir, I mean, it ain't a good record, but I'm trying to do better.
Better? Do you call this latest charge doing better? Appearing on television.
I'm sorry, sir, but my family was hungry.
Take him away.
Wait a minute, sir. You've got the wrong man. Don't you want to see a sample of me work?
Okay. Here's what we found on him when we picked him up.
This process of frightening is done by means of a given medium, the medium of pure cinema. Assembly of pieces of film to create fright is the essential part of my job.
Hitch had something that was only Hitchcock's. It's been imitated, never achieved by anyone who's tried to imitate it. They can't get that curious chemical mixture of suspense, of wit, of romance, of irony, and of anxiety. The anxiety is what's made him one of the major artists of the 20th century.
He was always using the elements of cinema itself in its purest form, so you're sort of always driven into areas that he has made the finest film in because it was the best idea and he did it better than anybody.
His artistry is so brilliantly deployed in so many instances at so many levels that you don't even notice it. You're too deep inside the picture.
He created a genre. He became an adjective. He was Hitchcockian.
If you have a word like Hitchcockian, that meant he has terrific relevance to us in certain areas of the way we experience the 20th century in general. He captured a part of it and spoke about it and defined it in a way that nobody else did.
Well, everybody always says that could have been straight out of a Hitchcock film, don't they? I mean, people still regard Hitchcock as the maestro, the master of suspense.
Some stories to tell you, stories that deal with suspense, mystery, and the macabre. The point I wish to prove is that you will be caught up in the frightening mood of this tale, despite its introduction by such a jovial, cheerful person as myself. So stop that chuckling and let's get on with it.
In an unparalleled career that spanned over 50 years, Alfred Hitchcock thrilled audiences with hugely popular movies while creating and expanding the language of cinema.
He managed to be both tremendously successful in reaching huge audiences, just endless series of fantastic movies that again had one eye on the audience and another eye on exploration of the medium.
Beginning with silent films, Hitchcock attracted an ever-growing audience and inspired generations of filmmakers with his one-of-a-kind formula of romance, intrigue, and suspense.
One of the few questions he ever asked me is, what do you want the audience to feel at this point? What do you want the audience to think? His concern was always with the audience.
But for all his commercial success, what he struggled to achieve most often eluded him.
Alfred Hitchcock never won an Academy Award, which is remarkable because the movies don't regard suspense pictures as, honest movies. You have to have deeper drama and deeper meaning.
It was as if there was no way a director could be that successful and audience-pleasing and still be considered an artist.
He probably had the quality of being one of the few geniuses who could also be a good showman. Did it take away from his genius? Well, if you're a salesman, and a showman, you can't be a genius. And look at the type of pictures he makes.
You put your particular stamp so the audience has that name recognition. A Steven Spielberg picture, a George Lucas picture, you know what they are.
The incredible genius of Hitchcock is that this man was able to be so commercially successful and at the same time be a deeply, deeply personal filmmaker. And it didn't matter if 90% of the audience wasn't aware of that, of where he was taking them, but he was taking them on this very personal journey of his psyche.
I feel that Hitchcock knew darkness and that he knew it very well. I'm not quite sure how he knew it, since he had lived pretty much a charmed life. He'd almost always done what he wanted to do. He'd had his success from the early 30s. So it was strange to me that he knew so much about this darkness. And I think that there's no telling where he drew on this.
You know what I think? I think that we're all in our private traps, clamped in them, and none of us can ever get out. We scratch and claw, but only at the air, only at each other. And for all of it, we never budge an inch.
That was his way of saying, somewhere inside of you, and hence inside of your house, inside of your neighborhood, inside of your city, is something dark and disturbing and possibly evil. The entire world was his companion, and they shared secrets, and he had the most to tell. And so he got to tell them every time he made a movie.
Let's start from the beginning again, Jeff. Tell me everything you saw and what you think it means.
In 1920, at the age of 21, Alfred Hitchcock, frustrated at his job in the advertising department of a telegraph company, took a portfolio of his drawings to famous players Lasky, the London branch of an American movie studio. He was hired on the spot. For the son of a Cockney greengrocer who had spent a solitary childhood under the spell of American silent movies, this bold step would mark the beginning of a lifelong career in film, an art form that had been born, like Hitchcock, at the turn of the century. Here he met Alma Revel, already an accomplished writer and editor, a woman who would change his life.
He told me that he went over to the studio with his portfolio and, in fact, didn't meet my mother, but she was already working there and had worked there for quite a while. But being a gentleman who didn't have as good a job as she did, he didn't speak to her for a long time because that would not be considered proper.
Yet they would collaborate, working on pictures in London and in Germany. They discovered they shared a passion for film and for each other.
He proposed to her coming back on the boat across the English Channel, which tends to be a little rough, and she was very seasick. And he says, I think she said yes. She sort of burped, but I took that for a yes.
Alma Revel, who became Mrs. Alfred Hitchcock, was the one person in whom he had
total faith about movies. She was absolutely the determining factor in anything he did.
Working with Alma, Hitchcock dedicated himself to learning every aspect of the silent film craft. In 1925, he was offered the chance to direct with The Pleasure Garden, a romantic melodrama that was to be the first of a three-picture contract. But the distributor refused to release it, calling it highbrow and arty. Their second film, The Mountain Eagle, fared no better. Hitchcock was crushed. Both he and Alma understood that if his third film failed, he would most likely never direct again. Hitchcock next chose The Lodger, a dark thriller about Jack the Ripper.
I took the first 10 minutes of the film to show a piece of news and a body being dragged out of the River Thames. And then I showed what happened to that piece of news in all form: broadcasting, wire service, scintillating running signs. But each time I added a piece of information about Jack the Ripper. He only did it on Tuesday, only fair-haired girls. Then I followed one blonde home to her house, and down in the basement, they're talking about it. And the lights begin to go down, slowly and slowly. And suddenly Mother says, "Dad, put a shilling in the meter, the gas is going down." By this time the place is in darkness, and there's a rat-tat-tat at the front door. As the door opened, the gas came up. There was a man standing with a cloak and a black bag. Obviously the Ripper. And then later on in the film I showed how he paced up and down the room.
He developed the technique of filming the Lodger's pacing through the glass ceiling. I'm sure that Alma was with him all the way on that and advised him how long it should run, the tempo, you know, all of the things that make that scene as innovative as it was.
The Lodger was a smash. It was his third film. And everybody said, "Wow, you know, young man with mastermind." That was his favorite headline.
Hitchcock explored another world of violence, anxiety, sexuality, and murder, themes that would become his trademark. Both critics and audiences embraced it. At the age of 27, he became London's most celebrated director. Before the end of the year, Hitch and Alma quietly married. After a honeymoon in St. Moritz, where they would return to celebrate most anniversaries, they came home to London. It was the first time either of them lived away from their families. The Hitchcocks celebrated their first Christmas by sending their friends a handmade gift, a jigsaw puzzle that revealed his profile. Did he know this playful gesture would someday become the visual signature of the master of suspense? In July 1928, their only child, Patricia, was born.
My earliest memory of my father is being at our country house in England, in Surrey, and my father had such a good time. He loved getting hold of the movie camera and being as silly as he could be and making everybody else be as silly as they could be. All the talk at home was about the movie that they were going to do, what stories they were interested in. This literally went on, I would say, throughout our entire lives when I was living at home. So it was a very, very happy environment that I grew up in.
How do I look?
Well, now, wait a minute.
In 1929, after six pictures that had only been moderately successful, Hitchcock started making Blackmail, his first thriller since The Lodger. Before it was over, he would face a revolution in movie making that thwarted many careers, the advent of sound. Blackmail demonstrated that not only could he use sound innovatively and dramatically, But there was a growing audience for his macabre themes.
I say, it's not me you want. It's him. Ask him.
The picture was a triumph. On the heels of Blackmail's success, he formed a publicity company to promote himself and his newsworthiness. In this way, he began creating himself as the master of suspense.
The miracle of a career like Alfred Hitchcock's or John Ford's and Howard Hawks, they came along at the dawn of the movie industry and were able to help invent it and help develop it.
Between 1934 and 1938, Hitchcock made a series of films including The Man Who Knew Too Much, The 39 Steps, and The Lady Vanishes.
The thrillers that Hitchcock made must have appeared to audiences at that time like nothing they had ever seen before.
I know you think I'm crazy, but I'm not. I'm not. For heaven's sake, stop this train. Leave me alone. Leave me alone.
Those are the films that really put him on the international map.
In 1938, The Lady Vanishes won the New York Film Critics Award for Best Film. On his first visit to New York, he was mobbed for autographs. That made no difference in Hollywood, where his repeated attempts to secure a contract failed. No studio believed he could make a successful Hollywood picture. Eventually, David O. Selznick, the notoriously temperamental independent producer, saw in Hitchcock a rare blend of artistry and aggressive self-promotion, much like himself. He offered a 7-year contract to begin with an epic screen version of The Titanic. After 23 movies in less than 14 years, Britain's most celebrated director was going to Hollywood. Hitchcock took his personal movie camera and recorded his family's Atlantic crossing, their arrival in New York, and their rail journey to California.
We came out to California on the Super Chief, and he loved going around and taking movies, loved doing that, took everything in Hollywood.
This hand-cranked 16-millimeter diary chronicles his first drive down Hollywood Boulevard, Alma at the wheel. Selznick, deep into his legend in the making, Gone with the Wind, had grand ambitions for his new director. Their first project, Titanic, had evaporated. Selznick couldn't find a boat to sink. He assigned Hitchcock the movie version of a best-selling novel, Rebecca.
I didn't expect the whole staff to be in attendance.
Miss Danvers orders, sir.
Sorry about this, won't take long.
Hitchcock offered a treatment that relied on the keystone of his British success, the visual thriller. Selznick demanded a gothic romance, true to the novel.
This is Mrs. Danvers.
How do you do?
How do you do? Why don't you go? Why don't you leave Manderley? He doesn't need you. He's got his memories. He doesn't love you. He wants to be alone again with her.
You've nothing to stay for. You've nothing to live for, really, have you?
Look down there. It's easy, isn't it? Why don't you? Why don't you?
Liked to be the boss. He really liked complete control, and I'm sure that his relationship with Selznick must have sometimes had its difficult moments, because Selznick really rather liked to be the boss too.
Hitch did not like confrontation. He didn't like, so you can imagine how he felt about Selznick, who was the most confrontational, most quote interfering producer around. Selznick referred to Hitchcock's way of shooting as that goddamn jigsaw puzzle way of shooting, because it was all pieces and it wouldn't fit except one way.
Maxie! Thank heaven you've come back to me.
Are you all right, Tommy?
Oh, yes, sir.
Are you all right?
Mrs. Danvers, she's gone mad. She said she'd rather destroy Mandalay than see us happy here.
Look! The West Wing!
Unlike Hollywood directors who shot their films so they could have choices in editing, Hitchcock had always planned his shot by shot, with no alternate coverage. Selznick bristled at this technique. It left him few options in editing.
My father was a very patient man and never lost his temper, ever. So he would just wait, you know, until David would come around, and eventually he came around.
Rebecca, in the end, would be a Selznick production. While Hitchcock began his next picture foreign correspondent on loan out to another studio, Selznick, to Hitchcock's frustration, edited and re-edited Rebecca, re-recording much of the dialogue and personally selecting the music. Finally, Rebecca premiered in March 1940 at New York's Radio City.
The enormous success of Rebecca is probably a mixed blessing for Hitchcock. The film won several Academy Awards, including Best Picture, but Selznick is the one who received the Oscar. And I think Hitchcock greatly resented that. And at that time vowed, you know, that he would ultimately have to achieve greater independence.
The other nominated films included such American classics as John Ford's The Grapes of Wrath, Chaplin's The Great Dictator, Cukor's The Philadelphia Story, and amazingly, Hitchcock's second American picture, Foreign Correspondent. Without Selznick's interference, Hitchcock made Foreign Correspondent and brought to the American screen a thriller, using the techniques that had made him famous in Britain. But the world was now at war, and for Hitchcock, the truth of war would not be found on the battlefield, but in the lives of ordinary men in extraordinary circumstances. As he would also do in Saboteur and Lifeboat, Hitchcock focused not on the political, but on the personal.
If there'd been any other sort of crime, if a man had stolen because he was starving, even if a man committed murder to defend himself, maybe I wouldn't tell the police. But there's only one reason why a man commits sabotage. That's worse than murder.
In Saboteur, a young munitions worker is wrongfully accused of sabotage.
He loved the story, and I think most of all he loved Norman Lloyd. This is where he and Norman first got to know each other.
I was fresh from the New York theater. I had never made a film.
Get out of here! Get out of here!
He said, I'd like to get an actor to play the heavy in this picture who no one has seen before.
With Saboteur, Hitchcock created an American 39 Steps, climaxing with a spectacular struggle atop America's greatest symbol of freedom. These set pieces, action scenes in dramatic settings, would become a Hitchcock signature.
When you choose a location, it must not be a background to me. The goings-on in that location must be involved in the story.
Come on, Fry.
He said, would you like to see the Statue of Liberty scene? And I said, well, we haven't shot it. He signaled an assistant, and they brought it. It looked like a scroll, you know, and he'd laid out every shot.
As on every film, Hitchcock storyboarded each scene down to the last detail.
I'll get you sleep.
He knows how to find the right place to stage the right dramatic and emotional moment. And nobody else sees it except him. And he puts it on the screen, and then we all see it.
To get you up that close to it, to expose its rivets, its contours, to expose it from these odd, oblique angles, and then to set this terrible conflict on top of it and make it a place of peril, is a very disorienting thing to do. And you're thinking about this as you're watching this guy cling for his life, and all you're hearing is the wind. You know, no music. And it's so chilling.
Now, quick. Sleeve. Sleeve.
On a cue, this camera went up towards the ceiling as my hand slipped off. I did various balletic movements of falling and a great scream which I brought from my Shakespearean days.
By 1942, Hitchcock had become firmly ensconced in American culture. Though Saboteur, Suspicion, and Mr. and Mrs. Smith had been less successful than Rebecca, he knew, like Frank Capra or Orson Welles, that he wanted to make Hollywood films as his own producer, with no oversight. Fortunately for Hitchcock, Selznick again loaned him out to another studio to direct Shadow of a Doubt. Hitchcock, Thornton Wilder, author of the classic Americana, Our Town, and Alma, went in search of a perfect setting. In Santa Rosa, you couldn't even tell the world was at war, but beneath the tranquility lurked another sort of enemy.
Mother, I'm going downtown and send a telegram.
My darling, who do you know to send a telegram to?
I know a wonderful person who'll come and shake us all up. Just the one to save us.
You've gone crazy. What do you mean, save us?
All this time, there's been one right person to save us. Mother, what's Uncle Charlie's address?
Uncle Charlie?
His favorite film that he made was Shadow of a Doubt. And the main reason it was his favorite was because he loved bringing menace into a small town.
Who are you?
Charlie.
Oh.
You bring a character in, such as Joseph Cotton played, who is so charming. Everybody loves him, but he's a mass murderer. And he thought that was wonderful. He liked that.
I know that you don't tell people a lot of things. I don't either. I have a feeling that inside you somewhere there's something nobody knows about.
Something nobody knows?
Something secret and wonderful. I'll find it out.
It's not good to find out too much, Charlie.
When I think of Shadow of a Doubt, and why was that movie so excruciating, for me anyway, to watch in that wonderful movie way, it had that appalling idea that someone you love may have done terrible things.
Middle-aged widows, husbands dead, husbands who've spent their lives making fortunes, working and working. Then they die and leave their money to their wives, their silly wives. What do the wives do, these useless women? You see them in the hotels, the best hotels, every day by the thousands, drinking the money, eating the money, losing the money at bridge, playing all day and all night, smelling of money, proud of their jewelry, but of nothing else. Horrible, faded, fat, greedy women.
They're alive, they're human beings.
Are they?
Here's that grown-up who you have adored more than all others, and of all people to have to be the one to uncover the dark, terrible truth of Uncle Charlie's profoundly disturbed mind is just appalling. You know, what if that happened in our family?
How do you know what the world is like? Do you know the world is a foul sty? Do you know if you ripped the fronts off houses, you'd find swine? The world's a hell. What does it matter what happens in it?
The casting of Joseph Cotton was absolutely brilliant. Really brilliant, because he's so suave, and I mean, he could be as evil as anything, and yet somehow it was this gentleman doing it, so you didn't really quite believe him. So, oh, no, 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 he's not going to do that. He's much too much a gentleman to do that.
Any film is going to be as strong, not as its hero figure or its lead or its identifying thing, but every film is going to be as strong as its villain. You've got to make the villain the most charming, fascinating, complicated person in the movie.
He had to be charming, attractive. If he weren't, he'd never get near one of his victims.
If you paint a sympathetic side, a whimsical side, a funny side, in addition to the dangerous side.
Bang, bang!
You've created much more interesting tapestry in your movie.
Ah, here she is. Now for my toast.
She finds out that indeed she is capable of almost the same thing her uncle is capable of.
I don't want you here, Uncle Charlie. I don't want you to touch my mother. So go away, I'm warning you. Go away or I'll kill you myself.
The sheltered life in the town of Santa Rosa where this young girl lived may have been her world, but it wasn't the world. Unfortunately, you see, today, evil has spread that every little town has had its share of evil.
Not yet, Charlie. Let it get a little faster. Just a little faster. Faster. Now.
Shadow of a Doubt marked a turning point for Hitchcock. It was, in many ways, his first truly American film.
It's a film where he's dealing with American actors, American setting, working with a great American playwright. I see that as a real, real pivotal film.
Despite Hitchcock's continuing friction with Selznick, he had learned much from him. Hitchcock's films now embraced bigger stars, Gregory Peck, Ingrid Bergman, Cary Grant, better budgets, and the grand scale of Hollywood production.
In Notorious, there's a famous shot where the camera's very high up at the party. They had a special crane built for this shot, and eventually the camera comes down, 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 all the way to Ingrid Bergman's closed hand, and she opens it slightly, and you see she's got the key. I asked Hitchcock, and I said, well, what's that saying after us? I said, in this party where all these people are doing all this, there's one item that is the crux of the whole situation.
Hello there.
Good evening.
Notorious is both espionage story and love story. What Nazi Claude Rains doesn't know is that his wife, Ingrid Bergman, is secretly in love with Cary Grant, a government agent, and has only married him for his secrets.
I'll keep the garden door open and I'll tell you that.
Like most Hitchcock films, it's never about what's on the surface, Germans or uranium.
The film can be about anything you like, so long as I'm making that audience react in a certain way. If you begin to worry about the details of what are the papers about that the spies are trying to steal, well, that's a lot of noise. I can't be bothered with what the papers are, what the spies are after.
It's like the scene when they go down to the cellar and they're looking through the bottles of wine, and you don't know what they're looking at. You don't really care. You're just worried that someone's going to come down and find them there. And then he knocks over a bottle and falls, and there's some kind of sand in it. And he says, what's that? They don't spend an enormous amount of time ever explaining it. Oh, it's something to do with, you know, something to do with the bomb or something.
We've got to leave things as we found them. Help me find a bottle of wine with the same label as these others.
But it isn't really sand, is it?
No, I think it's some kind of metal ore.
I thought of the idea they were collecting samples of uranium 235, from which the future atom bomb would be made. So the producer said, oh, that's a bit far-fetched. What atom bomb? I said, look, if you don't like a uranium 235, let's make it industrial diamonds. Because it makes no difference. It's what we call the MacGuffin. What's that? The MacGuffin is the thing that the spies are after, but the audience don't care.
I want you to take back a message to a Mr. Callender at the Foreign Office in Whitehall.
Then you are a spy.
I always think that's such a grim word.
What is the message?
It's a tune.
Tune?
It contains, in code, of course, the vital clause of a secret pact between two European countries. I want you to memorize it.
Oh, go ahead, do it.
The first part of it goes like this.
Those two men were in here last night. I overheard them telephoning.
What did they say?
Oh, a lot of stuff about the 39 steps.
You, you, you
what?
No, go on, go on.
Someone's going to warm them. How can you warm steps?
Never mind, go on.
He's part of the combine that built up the German war machine in hopes to keep on going.
Something big?
It has all the earmarks of being something big.
Clause 27. The secret clause? I know it. Clause 27. But they mustn't know it.
Remember, say nothing.
Hitch's favorite MacGuffin, he said, the one he was happiest with, was the one in North by Northwest.
Tell me, what's Van Damme up to?
Oh, you could say he's a sort of importer-exporter.
Of what?
Oh, government secrets, perhaps?
Government secrets. End of story. So, in other words, everybody's concerned about what James Mason does. But the audience really doesn't give a damn. It's just an excuse to hang your hat on.
David Selznick, however, did care about the MacGuffin. He couldn't understand who would want to see a movie about dust. So he sold off Notorious, script, stars, and director, to RKO with Hitchcock producing.
How do you feel?
Now Hitch could finally make the picture as he wished. Released in the summer of 1946, Notorious broke all records at Radio City Music Hall and eventually made $8 million in profit.
Now, just a minute, I'm with her.
No room, Sebastian.
Oh, but you must take me. They're watching me.
That's your headache.
No, please take me, please, please, please.
Forced to conclude his Selznick contract with a forgettable courtroom drama, The Paradine Case, Hitchcock began planning his independence. He wanted to make films that appealed not just to his commercial instinct, but that inspired him artistically. Astonishingly, his first two movies as an independent were not at all what his audience expected. Rope and Under Capricorn were cinematic experiments designed to be shot in extended, unedited takes, the camera following the action in real time.
Open it.
Alfred Hitchcock was one of the great experimentalists in commercial movie making. He's the one who dared to think that there'd be an audience that would be excited to see a picture done in 12 unbroken takes with rope. And whether or not that picture is successful artistically or whether or not it was successful commercially, he did that. He dared to do that.
I've always wished for more artistic talent. Well, murder can be an art too. The power to kill can be just as satisfying as the power to create.
You've murdered! You've strangled the life out of a fellow human being who could live and love as you never could. And never will again.
What are you doing?
It's not what I'm going to do, Brandon. It's what society's going to do. I don't know what that'll be, but I can guess. And I can help. You're going to die, Brandon, both of you. You're going to die.
In many ways, this newfound freedom proved more disastrous than Selznick's interference. Throughout the 40s, he'd made his name synonymous with elegant villains, electrifying set pieces, gothic romance, and intriguing plot twists. He soon discovered that his audience had little interest in his dark experiments. Badly in need of a hit, he became enthralled by a little-known English detective novel. But none of the first dozen screenwriters he approached could make sense of the oblique, erotic story. Finally, he turned to thriller master Raymond Chandler to create Strangers on a Train. Here, the Hitchcockian themes of good and evil, light and dark, come together, beginning with a chance encounter in a club car.
Excuse me.
Two fellows meet accidentally, like you and me. No connection between them at all. Never saw each other before. Each one has somebody that he'd like to get rid of. So, they swap murders.
Swap murders?
Each fellow does the other fellow's murder. Then there's nothing to connect them. Each one has murdered a total stranger. Like, you do my murder, I do yours.
We're coming into my station.
For example, your wife, my father. Crisscross.
What? Is your name Miriam?
Why, yes. How did you...
For the first time, Hitchcock began to marry the deeper, darker themes that sparked his artistic interest with the seductive thrills his fans expected. Strangers was to be the hit he needed, foreshadowing the great films of his golden era.
The thing that I marvel about with Hitchcock is that this man who reached his 50s at the same time the century reached the 50s made a string of personal masterpieces that I think were the most deeply felt pictures that he had made, and also the most ambitious, starting with Strangers on a Train, actually, and including Rear Window and Vertigo and on through The Birds and Marnie. He just kept challenging himself.
He could get the stories he wanted. He could get the writers he wanted, and he wasn't made to take somebody that he didn't think was quite right for a part. And so it was a glory period for him.
Dial M for Murder, Hitchcock's first film with Grace Kelly, was shot in 3D, a process that had drawn huge crowds to low-budget horror films. Hitchcock, the showman, recognized this, while Hitchcock, the artist, made it his own.
His movies became almost like a series. So when they'd say, oh, the new Hitchcock film is coming out, everybody would say, oh, great, we're gonna go, and where's he gonna appear? My favorite film of all of the Hitchcocks was Rear Window. That hit my particular sensibility the most.
Rear Window marked yet another turning point for Hitchcock. This time, he blended his artistic vision with elements that would reach an even wider audience: Hollywood stars, romance, intrigue, and glamour. It was this film that caught the attention of the young European critics and filmmakers like François Truffaut, who recognized him not just as a hitmaker, but as a genius.
How's your leg?
It hurts a little.
And your stomach?
Empty as a football.
You know, the French used to refer to Rear Window as Hitchcock's testament film, meaning that looking at that film was a kind of testament to the kind of cinema that Hitchcock represented. You're constantly being shown Stuart looking at something, and you see what he sees, and then you see his reaction. For Hitchcock, that was the essence of filmmaking.
Oh, dear. We become a race of peeping Toms. What people ought to do is get outside their own house and look in for a change. Yes, sir. How's that for a bit of homespun philosophy?
Reader's Digest, April 1939.
Well, I only quote from the best.
Rear Window is a film about film itself. It's about why we go to the movies. It's about the gaze. It's about voyeurism. It's about the safety of voyeurism, the safety of going to the movies. You stare at the screen, and the screen doesn't stare back at you.
I've seen bickering and family quarrels and mysterious trips at night, and knives and saws and ropes, and now since last evening, not a sign of the wife. All right, now you tell me where she is.
I don't know.
What's she doing? Where is she?
Maybe he's leaving his wife. I don't know. I don't care. Lots of people have knives and saws and ropes around their houses, lots of men don't speak to their wives all day. Lots of wives nag, and men hate them, and trouble starts. But very, very few of them end up in murder, if that's what you're thinking.
It's pretty hard for you to keep away from that word, isn't it?
This guy who is deliberately removed from life, this man who is a photographer, an observer, is reluctant to go the emotional distance with Grace Kelly because he sees her as not being suitable.
Where's that wonderful music coming from?
Some songwriter over there in the studio apartment. Well, he lives alone.
So
probably had a very unhappy marriage.
Well, it's enchanting. It's almost as if it were being written especially for us.
No wonder he's having so much trouble with it.
In the course of the movie, she's allowed to plunge into his fantasy world.
Come on, get out of there.
And reveal herself to be daring and courageous. And, you know, in that scene, which I think is one of the most romantic scenes in movies, actually, in its own perverse way, when he's looking across at Grace Kelly, plunged into danger because of his own sort of sick, voyeuristic fascination with what's going on in that apartment.
Yeah! Oh, no.
No, that's when he falls in love with her, I think.
Look, the wedding ring. Turn out the light, he's seen
him. But all I wondered when I was watching that movie is how's he gonna end this? He is like an audience, he is forced to sit there and in that chair and watch that movie play out in front of him.
Hitchcock had rarely been happier. He was working with stars he knew and trusted, and a new writer who burnished his suspense with sophisticated dialogue and seductive characters. After Rear Window, Hitchcock again chose to make a mainstream picture, To Catch a Thief, a romantic caper pairing Grace Kelly and Cary Grant. But then something unexpected would pull him away from movies.
Albert Hitchcock Presents was my first glimpse of this rather elegant, avuncular man coming out and with his sly wit, introducing his own stories.
Good evening. I'm Alfred Hitchcock, and tonight I'm presenting the first in a series of stories of suspense and mystery called, oddly enough, Alfred Hitchcock Presents.
When Hitchcock's agent and friend Lou Wasserman approached him with the idea of doing a series, he resisted. It was unthinkable in Hollywood for a director of Hitchcock's stature to do something as crass as television. But Wasserman insisted, having had great success putting Walt Disney on television the year before, he had a vision of Hitchcock in America's living rooms every week.
Norman Lloyd tells a wonderful story when my father was doing the lead-ins for the television show, and Norman would read, you know, what they were supposed to be, and he says, my God, Hitch will never do this.
Someone has at last found a practical use for my talents. He reasoned that since I have been frightening people for years, why not birds? The job is somewhat restricting, but I have a number of visitors. One little girl and a Tid Woodman are quite bothersome. They seem to be under the absurd impression that I'm going to go dancing up the road with them.
He may have been aware that appearing on television once a week was not in keeping with what other filmmakers were doing. William Wyler was not appearing on television.
People actually could look at him and know him, much like a movie star. Movie stars sell their presence all the time. And their power comes from that, and so did his.
Shrunken heads are a hobby of mine. Collecting them, of course, not making them. Takes too long to make one. First of all, you must wait until the original owner of the head dies. I haven't the patience for that.
It's very encouraging to have success, and certainly the television series was a tremendous success for Hitchcock. He also liked the challenge himself, and he'd go down and shoot one of those TV shows every so often, and again, it was like checking your chops. He did, I think, 20 out of the several hundred that were done.
Alfred Hitchcock Presents marked just the beginning. It begot a series of short story anthologies with titles like Tales My Mother Never Told Me, The Alfred Hitchcock Mystery Magazine, and an explosion of other merchandise. It ran for more than 10 years. Hitchcock, now in front of the camera, became an international television star.
Bonsoir, cher touriste. Je crois que ceci prouve que dans certains cas, l'avion ne peut jamais remplacer le train.
There is a paradox in his wanting to be seen as an artist and wanting to be a celebrity. In those days, the two weren't usually built into one person.
It was the most honest statement of what he was doing. He was entertaining us. The fact that he had a kind of ironic sense of humor about it was fine. I mean, most great artists do have an ironic sense of humor about what they do.
If he had not appeared on his TV shows, I think we might take his work a little more seriously. But he was a star.
Not surprisingly, television embraced and liberated the showman in Hitchcock.
That was beautifully put. In fact, after hearing that, there's nothing more I wish to add. So, good night until next week.
Hitchcock's television success brought him great wealth, and with that, financial independence. It also brought another kind of freedom. By giving his audience what they wanted week after week, he now felt free to move into more personal and challenging territory.
Give me your hand.
What he might call stories they wouldn't let me do on television.
I want you to follow my wife. No, it's not that. We're very happily married.
Well, then...
I'm afraid some harm may come to her.
From whom?
Someone dead. Scotty, do you believe that someone out of the past, someone dead, can enter and take possession of a living being? If I told you that I believe this has happened to my wife, what would you say?
Jimmy Stewart, a retired detective, falls in love with a woman he is trailing, saving her life when she attempts suicide. But his fear of heights leaves him paralyzed, unable to save her a second time.
He needed his heroes to be very flawed. He could grab that little thing that you mentioned while you're at the amusement park. Oh, I'm afraid up here. And make a movie about it. And it turns out to be vertigo. If there had been some other reason why James Stewart wouldn't go up that chapel, I don't think it would have meant as much to him.
Months later, he encounters a living image of his dead love.
Hitchcock's exploration of relationships comes back again and again to certain ambivalent feelings, whether it's the inability of someone to recognize the potential of someone that they're involved with, or whether it's the question of why do you love somebody? Do you love them for what they are or what you imagine they could be?
I heard that one before, too. I remind you, someone used to be madly in love with, but then she ditched you for another guy, and you've been carrying the torch ever since. Then you saw me and something clicked.
Well, you're not far wrong.
Well, it's not gonna work, so you better go.
Please, let me come in.
The female characters that Hitch would choose, he would take these women and try to tear them down. With basically the man's control.
Color your hair.
No.
She would not want to give in, and he would insist upon it.
Judy, please, it can't matter to you.
If I let you change me, will that do it? Will you love me?
Yes. Yes.
All right. All right, then I'll do it. I don't care anymore about me.
Vertigo's like the perfect director's movie. Because directors are constantly creating illusions, and Hitchcock created this illusion that Jimmy Stewart falls in love with. And we, as directors, are aware of that process of making the audience fall in love with our leading ladies. We dress them, we put makeup on them, we put them in scenes in order to draw the emotions of the viewers, and we create illusions. When I saw Vertigo, and as a, you know, a man in my middle age, as I, you know, get close to 60, I mean, the movie means entirely different things to me. But it's still flawless. It's a flawless movie. I mean, you know, and there are very few of them. There's not a missed note in the movie.
To Hitchcock's disappointment, Vertigo failed to draw his audience and left the critics unmoved and baffled. Vertigo remained unseen for over a decade, during which time it garnered a reputation as Hitchcock's lost masterpiece.
Vertigo is the most subverted of all. I mean, here's this, you know, all-American everyman, but boy, has he got a problem about that girl. When he finds that he's been had, he's not very forgiving. He loses everything twice.
He made you over, didn't he? He made you over just like I made you over. Only better. Not only the clothes and the hair, but the looks and the manner and the words. And those beautiful phony trances. And you jumped into the bay, didn't you? I'll bet you're a wonderful swimmer, aren't you? Aren't you? Aren't you? And then what did he do? Did he train you? Did he rehearse you? Did he tell you exactly what to do, what to say? You were a very apt pupil, too, weren't you? You were a very apt pupil. But why did you pick on me? Why me?
It's a unique piece of work that I think is probably Hitchcock's most personal movie. The most controlling of all directors confronts his own fear of falling into the depths of emotion, and also, obviously, the whole thing with death.
I heard voices. God have mercy.
When he was making Vertigo, it was found out that my mother had cancer. And my father had been absolutely devastated by this because he couldn't imagine living without her. We went to the opening up in San Francisco, and she couldn't go. I took him up the room. He didn't want to go to the party. And he says, I don't know what I'm going to do without your mother. So I said, well, you're certainly no good to her now, so there's the window. So why didn't, you know, if you can't live without her, there it is. And I walked out of the room and went down to the party and let 10 minutes go by, and then I went up to the room, and of course he was asleep, you know. I had to gamble. I had to take a big gamble.
To Hitchcock's relief, Alma's cancer went into remission.
I think my mother did become a role model for the women in his pictures, because they were independent, and a lot of them were feisty, which is what she was. If he found a story, he would have her read it, see if she thought it would make a picture. If she said yes, fine. If she said no, he didn't even touch it.
The real excitement for him was developing the script and imagining how everything would look. And this is where Alma played a critical role, as a screenwriter and as a confidant.
She looked at the first cuts of the films and made suggestions. But more than all of that she did, She kept his balance.
She was a total integral part of everything he did. And I honestly feel today that he would not have been the director he was without her.
He and Alma used to travel, and he wanted to go by a car so he could feel and see this. You wouldn't think that a man of his kind of sophistication would be that interested in what was happening on that kind of tourist level, but he was. He and Alma passed by the Rushmore monuments once, and then that was the idea for North by Northwest.
Well, I think most of the films I make are fantasies. They're not slices of life. They're all larger than life. North by Northwest was a nightmare, from one dreadful experience to another.
Hitchcock so boldly said, I'm going to create a suspense sequence in the wide open, completely flat terrain of this cornfield, and I'm going to make this as frightening and exciting as something that happens in a claustrophobic environment, which is the typical environment for suspense.
Cary Grant, who with Jimmy Stewart came to represent the two sides of Hitchcock's everyman, would make his last appearance for Hitchcock in North by Northwest, their fourth collaboration.
Hitchcock had great collaborators, George Tamasini, Edith Head, Bernard Herrmann, plus all the great screenwriters he worked with. He needed his collaborators. He was very smart about that. So all these things became what we perceive as the great Hitchcock movie.
North by Northwest quickly became one of Hitchcock's biggest moneymakers, as well as delighting the critics who welcomed, finally, his return to classic thriller form. He had now, at the age of 60, achieved a level of international fame unmatched by any Hollywood director. But if they believed that Hitchcock had no more surprises, they were soon to be astonished. For now, by blending his showman's instinct with his fierce artistic vision, he would create a film that would brand itself onto our culture and influence generations of filmmakers.
I became aware of Hitchcock, I think when I was probably in about sixth grade. We weren't allowed to actually go to movies except for Disney movies, but I heard about this film called Psycho, and my mother said something like, oh, there's this terrible old man, Alfred Hitchcock, has made this disgusting movie. It's supposed to be awful.
This was a film that really kind of changed my movie life, because I came out of that picture for the first time understanding what a director does, what a director can do. And the idea that this funny English guy had fashioned this movie, it made an impact.
A lot of people looked at this thing and said, what a dreadful thing to do, how awful, and so forth. But of course, it was, to me, it had great elements of the cinema in it. The content as such was, I felt, rather amusing. And it was a big joke, you know. And I was horrified to find that some people took it seriously. It was intended to cause people to scream and yell and so forth, but no more than the screaming and yelling on the switchback railway.
I was very surprised when I received the book that Hitch would be interested in making this as a movie. I understood at my very first meeting when he told me that there was a company that was making very inexpensive movies, way under $1 million. And he said, and I was wondering how it would be if we did one. And I thought, yes, I know exactly what you're saying. What if a really good director got in there, but not with the usual Grace Kelly budget, and did a really good movie? And I understood at that moment that Psycho would be a different movie than I thought it would be. I hit upon the idea of making it a movie about Marion Crane, not Norman Bates. And when I told him that and described the movie as I saw it in my head, up to where she gets murdered, I stopped there and he was silent for a while, and then he said we could get a star to play Marion. And his instant notion was that we get a star and then we kill her.
I thought it was absolutely a brilliant way of telling the story and of the way that Mr. Hitchcock works of manipulating the audience. She's a decent woman, but life is passing her by, and this is the last grab for happiness, but she can't do this sordidness anymore. She sees an opportunity. It's against her nature, but she does it. And she's a terrible thief.
Am I acting as if there's something wrong?
Frankly, yes.
So the audience is completely taken down this road. And then, wham, bam.
Well, the mattress is soft, and there's hangers in the closet and stationery with Bates Motel printed on it in case you want to make your friends back home feel envious. And the, over there.
The bathroom.
Yeah.
We had worked on the visual aspect of the movie, and then I went home and in 3 weeks wrote the script and brought it back. When I came in, he said, Alma loved it. And I knew that was the ultimate seal of approval. It was also his way of saying something nice about it without having to do the personal thing. He had trouble with that.
Better get back to the office. These extended lunch hours give my boss excess acid.
Why don't you call your boss and tell him you're taking the rest of the afternoon off? Friday anyway, and hot.
In the opening scene with John Gavin, I am in a white bra and a white half slip. When I'm packing after I've stolen the money, I am in a black bra and a black half slip. That's the dark side. Again, he's always doing that split personality thing, because he always has shown that everyone has this split personality, and it's the degree of the split that matters.
I've caused you some trouble.
No, mother, my mother, what is the phrase? She isn't quite herself today.
People don't realize today how extraordinarily shocking that movie was when it first came out. There were 1,000 people down at the old Mayfair Theater and about 500 of the New York press, and nobody knew what the hell to expect. So we're all sitting there watching this movie. It seems to be a movie about Janet Leigh stealing some money. And for about an hour or 45 minutes or whatever, that's what you thought the movie is. Suddenly she goes to take a shower and this thing happens.
She doesn't go just to clean her body. This is a cleansing of her soul. She's in that shower and you see the water and she's saying, yes, this is right. She's washing away not just the dirt from the road, but she's washing away the dirt that she put on herself by being a thief. She's washing this away. She's going back to reality and to being who she is. And that's why when this happens, it's so shocking.
Nobody had a clue that was going to happen. It was Janet Leigh, for Christ's sake. She's the star of the picture.
Even as it built, even as you saw this night, you still knew that she was all right, that she would get out of it because she was the star. There was total silence, and then there was a scream that just was blood-curdling. Everybody just held on to each other. I've never seen anything like that anywhere.
The pain is almost like blurred, and you're kind of in limbo, and it's like I was thinking, this can't be happening to me. It just can't be happening. What is happening?
Here's Janet Leigh, this gorgeous Hollywood movie star, and she's going to take a shower. And one perks up in all kind of ways at this thing, only to have go down what goes down, this most terrifying, frightening, appalling, heartbreaking thing you could ever imagine. You do see the slow terror of someone being stabbed to death, and not just the innocent nudity of someone being stabbed, but the sexual implications of it as well, obviously. And talk about a home run. I mean, that's clearly remains one of the most frightening scenes. It's not the kind of thing you look at now and go, oh gosh, nowadays people are doing so much scarier things. It's every bit as powerful as it was at the time.
Hitchcock removed from the shower scene a shot that contained nudity. You could see the victim's buttocks. High overhead shot. It was not an easy shot to get. He took it out because they probably would not have okayed the picture with that in. To me, I think that's maybe the shot that made me cry, because it represented all that was lost. The beauty of this human being who is no longer going to be with us.
I've had people say, I never believed that you were really dead. I couldn't let myself believe that. They could not accept the fact. They just, you know, it was like denial.
Well, I walked out of there at like noon, you know. What the hell happened? I thought I'd been raped, really. It was shocking. It was absolutely just, you just couldn't get over it.
The worst trick of the movie was being asked to transfer your allegiance to the murderer, although you didn't know it at the time. You believed that his mother had done it. So by showing you a sympathetic young man who cleans up after his mother's murders, you know, how can you lose? How can you not go with this guy? And the ability to manipulate the audience and move them in directions that they probably would not go in real life was a little bit frightening. It was thrilling.
When he's putting the car in the swamp and it starts to go down and then it stops and the audience went, oh, no! It's like they wanted the car to go down. They wanted him to get rid of it because they were so with him.
I believe in putting the horror in the mind of the audience and not necessarily on the screen. This film had a horrible scene at the beginning of a girl being murdered in a shower. But as the film developed, I put less and less physical horror into it, but the tension in the mind of the viewer was increased considerably. I was transferring it from film into their minds. So towards the end, I had no violence at all. But the audience by this time was screaming in agony, thank goodness.
I saw Psycho for the first time with an audience the day it opened in theaters all over LA, and I simply could not believe what was happening. I mean, the audience was yelling at the screen, was telling Vera Miles not to go down that staircase. Don't go down there. I had not heard anything like that since I was a little boy at cereals on Saturday afternoon. The audience reaction to Psycho was like nothing that I had ever seen or that Hitchcock had ever seen. When I met with Hitch shortly after the film opened, and I walked in his office, he went, like, who would have thought?
Finally, you see a movie that gives you imagery and ideas and editing styles and aggressive music used in a different kind of way, unlike anything I'd ever experienced before. I was absolutely terrified, traumatized, and very, very grateful for it. So I came out thinking, wow.
I was frightened Psycho for two reasons. One, it was shot in black and white.
in a day when everything was done in color, including television. And two, the star of the movie, Janet Leigh, got killed in the first half hour. And how are we going to explain that to people who came in the middle of the movie and didn't see Janet Leigh? He had a plan.
Before Psycho, audiences came to movies whenever they wished, often after they started. Hitchcock turned this to his advantage. In this way, he revolutionized America's movie-going habits.
I've suggested that Psycho be seen from the beginning. In fact, this is more than a suggestion. It is required.
It was the most brilliant stroke of merchandising for several reasons, not the least of which was it created an anticipation. Why won't he let me in? This changed it all. Psycho changed that whole practice.
The word of mouth on it was absolutely sensational. There were quite a few negative reviews. A lot of people didn't like Alfred Hitchcock making a dark, erotic movie, and a lot of people in the business didn't like it. I think Hitchcock was very secretly pleased with the success of Psycho. And while he may have been trying to base this pleasure on, see, I said if we made a low-cost movie, we'd make a lot of money. I don't think that was it. I think what he was saying was, they finally found me. They know what I'm capable of.
I don't know whether this man will go for my throat next, because he obviously has demonstrated that he will follow no rules. Whereas in the past, it seems like films always sort of were constructed where the filmmaker was invisible, and they were following sort of certain lines that were predictable. Hitchcock was the first one that says, I'm in control of this car, and I'm hijacking this plane, you know, and you don't know where you're going. I'm going to take you to some incredible and a wild and woolly country where your language won't be recognized. That sort of thing is, I think, what he did at that moment, and it was quite thrilling.
Oh, the birds. I loved the birds. I thought the birds was great. That was the most fascinating set to go on, because you had real birds, you had trained birds, you had fake birds. They were incredible, just incredible.
Hitchcock had owned the English novel The Birds for a number of years, but was frustrated in his attempts to translate it to the screen until he saw newspaper accounts of random violent attacks by birds on two California towns.
Everyone took the birds for granted until the birds one day turned on them. The birds had been shot at, eaten, put in cages. They'd suffered everything from the humans, and it was time they turned on them.
With The Birds, he hoped to make a horror film to top Psycho. At the same time, he sought to use its apocalyptic vision of man against nature to impress the art house critics.
When I think of The Birds, the first thing that comes to mind are the amazing set pieces, where these people are at great and terrifying peril at the hands of something as common and everyday as a bird.
That man's lighting a cigar.
You know, little birds.
Hey, you!
Games with points of view, with the fire racing across, where he cuts to almost still frame images of her face as she follows the fire.
He needed an encompassing shot that would be strictly objective, and Hitchcock always referred to himself as a subjective director. What he wanted to do was to get these birds coming in under the camera. That was accomplished by photographing seagulls on a 90-foot cliff off the coast here, and those were rotoscoped into the shot. Some people have called it a bird's point of view. He never did. He called that God's point of view. But what was happening behind the rotoscoped gulls was a fire A lot of things happening.
There are some 1,400 individual shots in The Birds, twice that of any other Hitchcock film. 371 are trick shots, many of them hand-painted and layered.
There was such great care given to all of this. He knew so clearly in his mind what he wanted to see on the screen. This is the instance where Hitchcock puts these women who are all together. They feel like they've, you know, they've got life really pegged. And putting them in situations that are really horrendous. And just turning them around and see how they come out. She just happened to be the catalyst for all of these emotions that were flying around. She was the new person in town.
Who are you? What are you? Where did you come from? I think you're the cause of all this. I think you're evil! Evil!
The victims of the villainy are not truly innocent. You know, there's something about them, there's some complicity that invites this danger to them. And, you know, that's very present in The Birds because I think those characters represent all of us. All of us who've taken nature for granted and abused it, and suddenly we're at risk.
So it comes time to do the scene where I go up the stairs and into that bedroom. And I said, Hitch, I really need motivation for this particular scene. We've just witnessed the birds attacking, doing these horrible things to people, tearing up homes and all of this. Why would I go up? Why would I do this? He said, because I tell you to. That. I had been told that they were going to use mechanical birds for that shot, which actually was a very kind thing to do. So the morning that we were to start that scene, it was a Monday morning, and the assistant director came in and he said, and he couldn't look at me. He looked at the floor and the walls and the ceiling, and I said, what's wrong with you, Jim? He said, the mechanical birds don't work and we have to use real ones, and out the door he went. So I think it was three prop men, and they just alternately hurled birds at me for 5 days. And during that time, every single time the Hitch would say cut, he was back in his office on the set immediately and closed the door. By Friday afternoon, I was completely exhausted and I was lying on the floor. I just got all of the birds off of me. And I just sat there and just sobbed from sheer exhaustion. It was really awful. It was really awful. I think he literally felt very guilty about what he had been putting me through.
We did use some stuffed birds, but they were never very satisfied. They're dead. We needed live.
Itch was an extremely complicated man. He always said he was a very simple kind of person, which is absurd. I mean, no simple person could have come up with an incredibly fabulous films that he did.
No. No!
At the end of The Birds, I was terrified. They had gained control. They no longer needed to attack families. One day nature can just smite us from the face of the earth. And that day they had chosen to wait.
As The Birds neared completion, Hitchcock began a covert campaign to ensure both its commercial success and its art house status. A retrospective of his work was arranged at New York's Museum of Modern Art, climaxing with the Bird's premiere. The film was presented at Cannes to the European film community, who already held him in great esteem. These efforts clearly mirrored his early publicity efforts in Britain. They not only celebrated his reputation as a master director, but helped to elevate the status of the thriller, a genre he created a half a century before and that now bore his name.
His approach to the publicity was as careful as his approach to making the movie. He was thorough. He also paid a lot of attention to the advertising.
I think Hitchcock was a brilliant self-promoter. What I mean is that he promoted himself in a really fascinating way that was fun for the audience and accomplished a great goal for him, which is it gave him power.
How do you do? I'm Alfred Hitchcock, and I would like to tell you about my latest motion picture, Marnie, which will be coming to this theater soon. Marnie is a very difficult picture to classify. It is not Psycho, nor do we have a horde of birds flapping about and pecking at people willy-nilly. We do have two very interesting human specimens, a man and a woman. One might call Marnie a sex mystery, that is, if one used such words.
Hitchcock knew that his next picture, Marnie, would be his most experimental. Using his box office clout and artistic reputation, he attempted to guarantee himself an audience by snaring Sean Connery at the height of the James Bond phenomenon as his leading man, and once again cast Tippi Hedren as the troubled Marnie.
Marnie is the story of a girl who's a compulsive thief. And she does various jobs and then runs up against a man who falls for her, knows she's a thief, but he's a little disturbed when he finds out that she's robbed him as well. It's a very intriguing job.
The colors. Stop the colors.
What colors?
Hitchcock attempted to visualize Marnie's psychological problems and their roots in her childhood.
This subject was not even discussed. It's what happens to you as a child, how it manifests itself as an adult. Those things were not even considered, and certainly not in the early 60s. And to do a film about this was extremely brave.
Marnie fell short, both critically and commercially. Hitchcock's first failure in nearly a decade. The New York Times even said that its shortcomings were rooted in Hitchcock's need to be recognized as an artist. After Marnie, Hitchcock's career no longer would be the same.
I think after Marnie, I'm not sure whether he couldn't get the people he wanted or the writers he wanted, but I think he was probably tired, too. And that bothered him, too. That really bothered him.
Anybody can tell you, as you get older as a director, it's just harder to do it. When the irony, of course, is Hitchcock was so celebrated in his 60s, but then I thought his work really started to decline.
I'm a big fan of Torn Curtain, which, as far as I can tell, is one of the unjustly underrated Hitchcock movies.
Cut it out! Don't be stupid. I was signed by experts. I can't take you. How do you say? One arm tied behind my back.
It also contains, to me, one of the greatest, greatest Hitchcock scenes of all time, and I don't know if it was Hitchcock's intention to respond to all the scenes in movies of humans killing each other and making it look terribly easy, and it just isn't easy.
I think Hitchcock woke up one day and decided, I want to show the audience how resilient the human being can be. It's not that easy sometimes to kill a human being. Sometimes it's effortless. Sometimes it's a bullet to the head. I think it's kind of scary, and in a sick, sad, twisted, odd way, it's also kind of funny in the Hitchcock tradition.
And suddenly it was just so shocking that it was right down to the primal elements of things, and I think that's a mark of anybody that has to deal with the horrific, is that at some point you have to remind the audience that they are flesh and blood, you know, and that's what all this is about, is it's about that primal, often forgotten but simple truth that we are, you know, encapsulated, this very frail, mortal package.
In 1967, he began shooting tests for Kaleidoscope, a film he envisioned would be made with the spontaneity and immediacy of a documentary. While these never-before-seen clips from Kaleidoscope only hint at what he might have been after, some of these elements were later expressed in Frenzy. In 1971, 45 years after The Lodger, Alfred Hitchcock returned to England to direct Frenzy. The experience would be bittersweet. After realizing his dreams in Hollywood, he found it difficult to work there.
You want to be full face when the winches stop there? I mean, we should almost pause there as well.
Well, yes, yes, yes.
Just here.
All the way full face until the very end when she goes by the camera and you pan round with her. And she goes in this door, but she's full face the whole time. She'll look off, she'll be profile when she looks off down the alley. You see, then she'll turn back.
Here is the scene of another horrible murder. This is the famous London wholesale fruit and vegetable market, Covent Garden. Here you may buy the fruits of evil and the horrors of vegetables. I've heard of a leg of lamb, a leg of chicken, but never a leg of potatoes.
The reviewers of Frenzy in the early 70s were effusive in what they were saying, not about Hitchcock, the master of suspense, but Hitchcock, the artist of anxiety. The word artist crops up in a significant number of reviews.
What's that round her neck? Looks like a tie.
Yes, it's a tie, all right. Another necktie murder.
Yes.
Well, we haven't had a good, juicy series of sex murders since Christie, and they're so good for the tourist trade.
I was privileged to see Frenzy with Alma, just the two of us. It started out with us, and then he sort of left the projection room. And when it was over, and I realized he'd come back, because that's an awfully good picture, I jumped up and turned around to Alma and said, "It's the picture of a young man." And she was weeping.
Hitchcock was a filmmaker. His whole life was making movies. That's what he lived for. I think it's an old fireman, you know. He, if there's a fire, you fight it. And you do that right up to the time you die.
At the age of 75, he made Family Plot. When asked at a press conference when he might consider retiring, he replied dryly, "After Reel 12.
I think he was a little sad that he wasn't respected more in his time. When they came to give him the Thalberg Award, he said, "Well, they must think I'm going to die soon if they're going to give me an award."
I think he felt very much an outsider. And, you know, when he got the special Oscar, the Irving Thalberg Award, all he said was,
"Thank you,"
and walked off. Everybody thought it was very funny, but it wasn't funny, it was Hitch. That's all he had to say. You know, it was like, "Finally, thanks."
But in the end, Hollywood recognized the enormous impact of Alfred Hitchcock, his films, and his legacy. A year before he died, the American Film Institute paid homage.
I beg permission to mention by name only four people who have given me the most affection, appreciation, and encouragement, and constant collaboration. The first of the four is a film editor. The second is a scriptwriter. The third is the mother of my daughter, Pat. And the fourth is as fine a cook as ever performed miracles in a domestic kitchen. And their names are Alma Revel.
The last time I met him was much, much later, and he was really old, and he was in a wheelchair, and had just recently been belatedly knighted by the Queen. And I think Alma had just had a stroke, and he was lonely, and that was the last time I saw him, and I'm very, very glad I did, because he died a few weeks later.
Hitchcock did what he did and created these works, and they are as meaningful today as they were then. And in a way, they have a special resonance now because they're a window on that time period. He was a complex artist who made commercial pictures that were also deeply personal.
This was a talent that just exuded from him, that he wasn't even aware of, that was coming across. He so often said, it's only a movie. And yet he had this power.
It's very difficult for critics, for people in general, to take serious what you're doing if you're doing something that is popularly entertaining and is about these subjects that we'd rather not think as part of decent human behavior. And I think Hitchcock was painted with that brush to a certain extent by Hollywood, by the community of critics and people that judge what's art and what's not. Because he was so entertaining, because he was so transparently fun, it was easy to miss the fact that he was dealing about something that was quite profound in a way.
It seemed like there was never a time when he wasn't making movies. I know there was, but there seemed like a time set aside for him. I almost had the feeling at times that he was supposed to be there making movies during this period of this particular century. I mean, what if he had been born 30, 40 years earlier? Think of what we would have lost.
Now, daddies and mummies, I think the time has come to lamb out of here. Suppose you take this opportunity to escape. Until next time, of course.